Hello, my brilliant home buyers and sellers. This is Freya, your real estate agent. Welcome back to another market update. In today's video, we are going to briefly touch on the numbers for the month of September. We're going to talk about some of the new changes that have been announced in the mortgage industry. What are some of the drawbacks and what are some of the benefits of those changes, upcoming changes? And also, we're going to touch on what the predictions are being made when it comes to the world of real estate in the next couple of months. That being said, let's get right into it. First things first, let's talk about the numbers. In the month of September, what we saw is that sales actually went up by 8.5% year over year. And we also saw a slight increase month over month, not by too much, but by 0.42%. However, that is an increase, right? New listings were also up by 10.5% year over year. And month over month, they were up by 44.16%. So we still had a lot of inventory coming to the market. And of course, majority of it was the condo market. Now let's talk about the active listings. They were also up year over year by 30.5%. Month over month, they were also went up by 13.06%, which means again that homes were moving slowly, both comparing to last year and comparing to last month. Now, when it comes to average prices, they went down by 1% year over year. We're still hovering over $1 million in the GTA when it comes to average home prices. However, month over month, we did see an increase up by 3%. In a nutshell, the story remains pretty much the same. Homes moving a lot slower. We have tons of inventory. The only change that we did see and notice is that sales actually went up year over year and month over month, which means that there is more activity in the market after some of the interest rates going down. However, they haven't gone down to a point where we saw a very active market. Now let's talk about some of the new changes that have been announced in the mortgage industry. Number one change that has been announced is that increased price cap for insured mortgages. Insured mortgages are the ones where you put less than 20% down, in case you didn't know. The maximum home price for insured mortgages is increasing from $1 million to $1.5 million, which means that the first-time home buyers can now purchase a home value up to $1.5 million with less than 20% down. Now, definitely, this is going to open up some opportunities in high-cost markets like Toronto or Vancouver. To give you an example, let's say if you're a young couple with good jobs, you make good money, you just don't have the big chunk of 20% down available, and you live in high cost markets like Toronto or Vancouver, now definitely will have access to homes that are a little bit higher. You will be able to get those homes even though you don't have that chunky down payment available. Number two is extending the amortization period from 25 to 30 years for first-time home buyers and anyone who is buying a newly built home. This will definitely help with lowering your monthly payments, making home ownership more affordable. Now, both of these things have, of course, benefits and drawbacks, right? So let's first look into benefits. Number one benefit, of course, you have over here is that you have more homes available within your reach. Number two is, of course, lower monthly payments. So with the longer amortization periods, which means you can enjoy your reduced monthly payments. So giving an example, let's say you are looking at a $700,000 home with a 30-year amortization, you could save nearly $300 a month compared to 25-year amortization. So this extra saving on a month-to-month basis can go towards so many other expenses, your future investments, or maybe a vacation, whatever your plans are, but a little bit definitely helps. Number three benefit is that it will boost for new construction, right? So by extending the 30-year amortization for mortgage options for newly built homes, what the government is trying to aim to do over here is to stimulate new construction, and to be honest, to help the builders, because they are right now devastated. The sales are not the same, and even for some of the projects to continue and move forward with, they have to meet a certain sale quota, which they are unable to do so, and hopefully we'll start seeing a little bit more housing supply coming to the market, as we need that desperately. Now let's talk about the drawbacks. Number one is more debt, more interest. While you will enjoy lower monthly payments that are appealing, of course, a 30-year mortgage means you will pay more in interest over time. For example, you have a mortgage of $665,000. The difference could be over $124,000 in extra interest paid over 30 years compared to 25-year mortgage. Number two is slower equity building. So of course, longer amortization period means that majority of your chunk of your money is going towards the interest, not towards your principal. This will delay the growth of your equity in your home, which means delay of your future financial plans like home renovations or using your home equity for other investments that a lot of people do. Number three is potential for higher home prices. So we already know that the competition between the million and 1.5 million for detached homes is pretty fierce because there's just not enough homes that are available and there's not enough supply as well because we are not building as many single detached homes as much as we're building condos, let's say. So what it's going to do is that we have more people come into that bracket, we could very well see that there will be an increase in competition and demand, and that will in return increase the price of those homes again. Number four is higher mortgage insurance premiums. So if you have a higher loan amount with less than 20% down, which means that your insurance premiums will also increase, something to keep in mind. So in my personal opinion, I think these changes increasing the price cap and amortization increase of 30 years look good on paper, but to be honest, these are not the solutions that we all need right now to help us to make housing more attainable for everyone out there, right? I believe that we need more options in terms of affordable housing, and the options that they have come up with or the changes they have come up with in the mortgage industry, I don't think have hit the nail right now. So that's my own personal opinion. People can have their own. I think it's pretty much BS what they have come up with, and I don't think this is really going to help a lot of people, and I don't think there's a lot of first-time home buyers out there who are going to aim to buy their first home to be $1.5 million unless they come from a very rich background. That can happen. Anyways, let's talk about another mortgage announcement that has been made, and I think this one is a good one. So starting November 21st, 2024, OSFI will no longer require lenders to apply the minimum qualifying rate for straight switches of uninsured mortgages. So this means that if you have an uninsured mortgage, typically you would have more than 20% or more than 20% down payment, and you're looking to switch lenders at your renewal, at that point, you would no longer need to pass the stress test to qualify for your mortgage at a higher rate, which was something you had to do before. Now, why this matters to you? Number one, of course, this will give you more flexibility. So you can now shop around for better mortgage rate at renewal without the risk of being disqualified due to the stress test, and potentially saving money during renewal as well. Number two, what this will do is it will increase competition. Of course, this will make the lenders fight for your business, right? So this change can boost the competition among the lenders, which means they will be more willing to give you better options when you're looking to make that switch for your business. And number three is fairness for homeowners. The removal of this barrier helps ensures that homeowners like yourself have the greater flexibility to secure a mortgage that fits your financial needs at the time of renewal. I personally think that this one is definitely a good one, and it will help a lot of people at the renewal. Something they came up with that is good. This change will take effect on November 21st, 2024. And that's it about when it comes to mortgage industry and the changes that have been announced. Now let's touch on what the next months will look like when it comes to our real estate world and home prices. Let's go right into that. So the next couple of months will be very crucial in terms of where we're heading in the world of real estate. Right now at this point, we are sitting at, when it comes to inflation, 1.6%, which is way below our target of 2%, which we were aiming for. The next two Bank of Canada announcements will be a game changer. Mark the dates. The first one is October 23rd and the second is December 11th. Now, of course, we know that we are heading towards interest rate cuts in the next 2 months with the prediction that we will be sitting at 3.5% at the end of the year. A lot of people are predicting that it will be half basis points cut, but I personally think that it will not be the case. I think they will slowly and gradually head towards that because we don't want to be again where we were before in terms of interest rates extremely low and demand going extremely high and then not having enough supply, right? Now, a lot of people also have their own predictions when it comes to average home prices, and here's my two cents on it. I think that once the interest rates start to go down, we will start seeing more activity in the market, especially the month of January. February will be a little bit more busier, as we usually see the winter months are more slower, but that might not be the case next year. So we will see a lot more activity. But when it comes to average home prices, it is a dance between the demand and supply. So it all depends on the supply. So let's first take a look at the supply and what it looks like right now. And we have to keep a close eye on what the supply will look like in the next couple of months to see where our average home prices will go towards. So in front of me is the Toronto Real Estate Board market update for the month of September. I wanted to show you what the month of inventory looks like throughout the GTA in different regions for all home types. So overall, we are sitting at 3.4 months of inventory. If you look at Halton region, it's 3 months of inventory. In Peel region, 3.4. In City of Toronto, 3.8. We're looking at York region, 3.4. Durham region is 2.2 months of inventory. And Whippy is the lowest, 1.9 only. Seems like it's still a bit of a seller's market there. If you look at the City of Toronto, which is heavily populated, especially in the central with condos, we are sitting at 4.8 in most areas, 5.4, 5 months of inventory, 3.7. So when it comes to condos, we are definitely not going to see an uptick in price, in average prices, as soon the interest rates go down, because we have quite a bit of inventory still sitting on the market. So overall, we are in a good shape when it comes to home supply for at least next 2 to 3 months. If, let's say, everything gets sold and nothing comes to the market, this is where we are sitting at right now. Even when the interest rates will go down, it will take some time for the current inventory to get absorbed by the demand that will come up. Also, do not forget that we do have many mortgage renewals that are coming up next year. And it can very well happen that many people who wouldn't be able to afford their homes at the new interest rates, even though they're lower, they are the people who got extremely low interest rates back in 2020 and now are up for renewal. Might end up leading towards selling their homes, unfortunately, which will definitely lead into more inventory coming to the market. However, if we do not have enough homes coming up to the market, the housing supply, when it comes to new homes being built, of course, we will start seeing a little bit more complicated situation. Some of the factors that we have to keep an eye on is the immigration. Of course, the immigration numbers will play a big role over here. And of course, the housing starts and what they look like. Now, we know that new construction has definitely been stalling because there's just not enough sales available to support those projects to move forward with. So those things will definitely play a key role in terms of the supply and where we will head towards. But I think that next 3 to 4 months, we do have enough supply to support the demand that will come up. But we don't know. I mean, only the future can tell. This is just my 2 cents. I don't think the prices will skyrocket right away. So don't fear that. But you have to pay very close attention to the housing starts, the immigration. Let's quickly take a look at this article that talks about the new immigration targets and what it will look like. So let's take a look at the recent article posted by CIC News that talks about what we know about the upcoming immigration levels plan. First of all, it talks about the temporary residents, right? In 2023, there were over 2.5 million temporary residents in Canada, accounting for 6.2% of the population, which Minister Miller says that the upcoming plan will target a reduction in the volume of temporary residents and it will be reduced to 5% of Canada's population over the next 3 years. When it comes to study permits, there will be also a reduction, and only 437,000 study permits will be processed in 2025. Overall, the international students are accounted for 42% of Canada's temporary residents in 2023. So that will be also reduced, of course, by quite a bit. When it comes to open work permits, that also is going to be reduced, and the changes eligibility to result in 175,000 fewer permits being issued over the next 3 years. Then they talk about the close work permits, which is basically employers hiring through temporary foreign worker program, and employers will no longer be allowed to hire more than 10% of their workforce through the temporary foreign worker program. So there's a reduction over there as well. When it comes to permanent residents, it is set a target of welcoming 500,000 permanent residents to Canada in 2025 and maintaining this target in 2026. I personally believe it is still quite high. However, if you go further down in this article, it says that recently Minister Miller has said that all options are on the table when it comes to number of permanent residents Canada will admit in coming years, and that changes would be significant. And of course, these changes are coming in because of the pressure of a lot of people living in Canada who have witnessed how the immigration levels have greatly affected the low stock of affordable housing and, of course, the healthcare system. So I guess coming up election will determine these numbers, and these numbers will be reduced by how much, we don't know yet, but this is what it looks like. We have to pay close attention to these numbers.
If the immigration numbers keep up the same trend and we do not have enough housing available, especially in the GTA where we find most of the people just end up coming to the GTA, we will very well be in the same situation where demand exceeded the supply and we just didn't have enough homes available. And that is a recipe for the average home prices to go up. So some of the factors to keep in mind on immigration numbers, housing starts, and the current supply that we have on hand, if you really want to know where the home prices will go moving forward. There you have it. This is your current market update. If you have any questions, let me know, and let me know what are your predictions. What are you and your friends are talking about among yourselves when it comes to real estate market? Let me know in the comments. I'm always curious to know. Until next time, I will see you in my next market update. This is Faryal signing out.